chance to share old memories and play our songs again. When I got to the garden party, they all knew my name. No one recognized me, I didn't look the same. But it's all right now, I learned my lesson well. You see, you can't please everyone, so you got to please yourself.
5 minutes after 9 o'clock, nice looking Tuesday morning. And when you hear that music, and it's Tuesday, it means Caroline Baldwin is in the studio, usually.
Usually, yeah.
Once in a while, you're calling in from somewhere.
But I'm here.
You're here today. How you doing? Anything different this weekend than normal?
Cooked out a lot. Hung out with the family. And
did you cook veggies on your grill?
I cooked corn on the grill.
See, was that your photo I saw on Facebook? Did you post a photo?
No. No, I don't think so.
Why do people post that stuff anyway?
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, it's okay. I don't want to see your plate. I'll say, maybe show me the whole table. Yeah, show me the Thanksgiving dinner. That. You got the turkey and everything. That's pretty. Maybe candles and
it's
stuff.
It's pretty there. But it's not pretty in a photograph.
Not usually.
To me, I don't see it.
I don't want to know what's on your plate. I just don't. Maybe I want to see the bucket of vegetables you picked out of the garden that you're getting ready to put on the table.
Yeah, right.
Kind of thing, but that's.
Do you know I have a hard time discerning between tomatoes? Like if I go to the grocery store and I buy an expensive tomato,
right,
opposed to the $1.29 tomato,
right,
I can't tell.
Yeah, it's.
Can you?
I try not to buy the expensive ones, so I will.
Well, I did I can see.
Oh, see, I will.
How much better could it be?
Go sometimes tomatoes if they get too high, and I do love tomatoes.
I do too, but how good? I mean, you know what makes a tomato good? Salt. Maybe. Salt is the secret ingredient.
Garlic.
Bacon. Yeah.
Bacon. Those kind of things just make the tomato all the best. It brings out the best flavor in the tomato. It's a little dash of salt, like you say. Or if you're getting them out of the garden, you just take like the little cherry tomatoes. They're kind of the little junk food things. They're like M&Ms that grow on vines. You just grab a handful and you sit there and pop them off, wipe them off on your shirt.
Right.
Who needs to wash them? It's if you're not using bad stuff or you've got your proper
If
you know what's on them, if you know what you've been doing, why do you need to go to the faucet? Just sort of rinse it off. Or if you got the watering can, maybe.
The one thing that might be there, cats might have sprayed it.
Well, but that's kind of hard to get a little high,
Oh, really? Okay.
I mean, you're going to smell that.
I saw a cat in my yard yesterday, and I thought, well, I never knew that cat was doing that there. Good thing I don't eat that.
Find you a coyote.
Whatever that is.
Find
me a coyote.
There won't be any cats left. They'll find their way. But no, it's,
Do you ever eat anything that, okay, I normally slice tomatoes, I slice onions, but do you ever eat any of those things like an apple? Just kind of hold it and go for it? Like, you ever eat an onion that way or a tomato?
No. My brother used to eat potatoes like that.
Really?
Yeah.
Raw?
Take and scrabble raw potato and take the salt shaker. Like an apple.
Really?
It's like, I couldn't do that. But no, the cherry tomatoes, eating those.
Cherry tomatoes, that's a different,
Even like because I like the real little, the little sweet 100s or sweet millions where they're the small, they're about the size of a marble or so, maybe a little bit bigger.
Oh, really?
The big shooter size to me, they're too big to just pop in your mouth. They're hard to bite without going squishing all over. So the little ones, you just pop them in your mouth and eat them. But.
Did I ever tell you a story about my brother Bob?
No.
He told me a story. He was in one of these, like a Morrison's,
like a
restaurant
cafeteria.
That used to be right here.
Right.
Where you're standing in line
and
you got somebody
style.
In front of you with a tray. So he had one of those salads and he took one of the tomatoes, one of those little cherry tomatoes out. But instead of popping them out, he took a bite out of it.
Okay.
And it squirted all over the back of the lady in front of him.
Cherry tomatoes are dangerous in public.
Just squirted everywhere.
As a similar one, I was one time, and I was in Red Lobster, and he had the bigger cherry tomatoes, like the salad. Other people who maybe grow them might know it as a Celeste. It's bigger than maybe the size of a golf ball.
Okay,
those ones, and I was trying to poke it with my fork in order to cut it into something more bite-sized. And when I went to poke it, it went boing.
Squirted.
No, it left.
Oh, it physically jumped off the plate. Oh, wow.
It took off.
Oh, wow.
And I didn't have my tomato.
And you have a phone call. Wow, what a picture that just gave me in my mind. Especially in
Red Lobster.
Did it hit anybody?
No, but it rolled off the table and onto the floor. That and then my poor tomato, you know, didn't roll out the door.
And by the way, if you ask me if the woman knew that she had tomato on her back, I don't know. I don't remember if my brother told her or just let it go. She'll find out when she gets home. Good morning. You're on the air with Carol Ann.
Good morning, Carol Ann.
Morning.
Question for you.
Okay.
If you recall, a few weeks ago, I called in regards to my orange tree and my key lime tree not blooming over the winter.
Right.
To give you an update. The key lime is now blooming.
Okay.
The blossom.
Okay.
Okay. It's unexpected because it did it so late in the year last year.
Well, that's...
I remember you talking about, like, trees have, like a built-in clock.
Right.
Has it reset itself?
If it's blooming now, is this about the time that it bloomed last year, you said, or last time it bloomed?
No. Last year, it bloomed early fall. No, late summer.
Okay.
And it gave me limes early fall.
Okay. Late summer and gave you limes early. Boy, they do mature pretty quickly, don't they? I was looking up to see because some trees do, like lemon trees will usually, they call them everbearing, where they will bloom multiple times during the year and they will set fruit during those other times as well, and that you can actually get it to, you know, get your fruit all the way to ripeness. It's not like the orange trees. If the orange trees put on a June flush with a June bloom, they don't always, the fruit doesn't always ripen before the temperatures get too cold. But I'm looking to see whether or not they're actually saying of when some fruit mature on the tree year round. This is on your key lime. So, principal season is early summer in South Florida and late summer further north. So, that just sounds as if your tree is finally possibly blooming when it's actually supposed to be.
Oh, okay.
That it's okay. One of those things, because key lime, we're a bit far north on those, you know, for them. And just trying to protect them as they get, you know, as the tree gets larger from freezing, because those are usually not grafted, at least most of us, sensitive to cold, and that may even be what'll slow down the blooming in the, you know, to get them to bloom earlier. Warmer damage of foliage occurs at about 30 to 32. Wood damage or death will occur below 29. Some warm locations outside of streams, extreme South Florida may be suitable for some in the home landscape. Full sun and, you know, protected location for us. But it could just be that it's because of our winters, you know, not wrapping up until March, that's not going to bloom that early spring for us up here.
Yeah. Okay, all right. Very good then. So maybe it was just off kilter last year and it's just now getting in state.
I just want
to let you know that at least a part of the mystery has been solved.
Right.
In regards, at least to the key lime.
Right.
Now, what's going to happen with my orange tree? I have no idea as of yet.
Do you know which orange tree you have?
You know what? The name of it has weathered off.
Right.
I've forgotten the name. I remember... or doing a little bit of research in regards to it, and for whatever reason, I just cannot recall it. But I know that I got it's supposedly a hardy fruit along the lines of a Valencia.
Okay.
That's what they compared it to.
Mm-hmm.
But they said it was a bit more even sweeter than Valencia.
Okay, but yeah, without knowing which one, because some of them, they bloom earlier And that's what happens, is that we're too cold sometimes at those times when they're supposed to be blooming. That, you know, it throws them off. How old are the trees? Or is that one?
This is their third season.
Okay, yeah, I'd give them time. That's even still part of it, too, is that getting acclimated into our seasons, especially if it was one that might have been a little better suited, say, for down south of Orlando.
Okay, and I may have misled you there. I apologize. Right. When I bought them in gallon pots,
okay,
they were about 1 foot tall.
Oh, gosh.
And I have had them in the ground personally. This being like about the third season.
Oh, yeah. They're still young trees.
Yeah,
they're still young trees. So that's, I wouldn't fret too much on it. Being they are still real small trees, where usually I'm saying fertilize three times a year, you want to take and break that amount of fertilizer that you would use three times a year and do it six.
Wow.
Yeah, okay. If you would have been putting, say, a pound on February, June, and September, you're going to go a half a pound February, April, June, 1st of August, 1st of September, and feed them more frequently but with less fertilizer.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, because otherwise it's such an extended, that 3 month period of time in between gets a little bit long for those young trees.
Okay.
So that all and right, that might I help.
I have only been doing it once a year.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, so you're saying that I should actually be feeding and fertilizing up to three?
Up to, with the trees that small, six times. About every other month, starting in February, ending in September.
Okay.
So normally we fertilize, like I have mature trees. I'll fertilize mine February, June, like the middle of February, first part of June, and before mid-September. But my trees are old. My trees are probably 15 years old now. I probably need to start thinking about replacing those ones, actually. The small trees, and they'll even recommend it on the bag, a smaller tree, even though yours are 3 years in the ground, they're still little trees. They're still small. Yeah. They're still growing. So to take whatever that quantity would have been for three times a year and take and divide it. And say, like I said, say it was a pound for February, make it a half a pound and do it every other month during that time period. Or every other month or every 6 weeks, yeah.
Okay. All right. Very good,
then. All right.
Very good. Hey, I really appreciate it.
You're welcome. You're welcome.
Okay.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Let me real quickly mention the phone number. If you would like to call Carol Ann, you can. You're invited to, in fact. The number is 622-9622. That is a sponsored phone number, sponsored by our friends at Climate Control. So we say it's the WOCA Climate Control Source Hotline, 622-9622. And we do have a call. Good morning. You're on the air with Carol Ann.
Yeah. Good morning, guys.
Morning.
Say, Carolyn, I see the watermelons are coming in pretty strong in the stores now.
Right.
And do you have a little secret on how you can tell a good one from a not-so-good one? Like my mom years back would always, what you would call, thumping them, tapping on them. And I don't know what the reason was that, what it was for, but she could always pick a good watermelon out. I got a reputation of always bringing the worst one home.
you bring home the one that wasn't quite ripe. Usually what you want to look at is on the bottom of the watermelon, where the watermelon sat in the field. You want that to be a nice creamy color. That means it sat there for...
Laid down on the dirt, you mean.
Right, where it laid in that dirt, that little patch there... Where it's not green, should be a nice creamy color. And they should be definitely heavy, for their size. If you pick up a watermelon, it doesn't have the heft you really think it should. I'd probably pass that one over. And I'm not real sure on how to thump them myself. Everybody does it, there's a certain resonance, a dull. And I guess I think that's that dull thump you're looking for. Again, that's the heft. That's the the solidness of the flesh for them. If it's a roadside stand and it's somebody that says, oh yeah, they came out of my field or they came out of my brother's field, I'll say, you pick me one. And they're usually pretty good at picking you out a good one out of their
I've never had a bad one.
I've gotten one or two that were,
really?
when you cut them open, they really weren't ripe.
Really?
And it just, it was a little disappointing where you don't finish one. I got one sitting in a cooler right now I have to get into.
Sounds good.
Yeah. I didn't get it cut open.
Would size make a difference? Like a larger watermelon?
No, size never makes a difference.
An older watermelon, would that make a difference?
Not necessarily. Watermelons, like anything else, are individuals. The big Charleston grays are those big, long, real long ones for big parties. If you've just got a fridge, the little round ones, it just depends on the size that you're looking for, how many people. Usually the long ones, I think you could probably get a little more watermelon out of it just because the way it slices, the slices are small,
I like the bite-sized ones. You just pop them in your mouth.
Watermelons?
They're good. It's a pain to peel them, but not bad. They come out the size of a pea by the time
I was going to say, you cut open a watermelon, you get the melon baller, and then you can have the little ones that you just pop in your mouth.
Yeah, right.
But
when you're done with that watermelon, is there any use for that rind, like in your garden?
Throw it in the compost.
Give it to the cowboy.
Throw it in the compost. If you have chickens, they like them. Birds do like them. If you have a neighbor who has cows, they like them. But you could compost them. Just break them up, throw them in the compost pile, or bury them in the in the garden. You can put a couple little pieces out if you got a flat bird feeder. The birds will eat them.
I'm on my way over to the store here, and I'm gonna kind of hope to finally get a good one. I'll take your advice a little bit and look for the brown or the yellow on the bottom there where it was laid on the dirt.
Right, you're looking for that creamy colored bottom on the watermelon over here. These two.
Wouldn't all of the melons have that because they all lay on the ground?
Well, they do, but you're looking for one that's got a nice, you don't want it to look too green yet because you figure all the melons all start out the same. It's as it's sitting there, the rest of the melon gets darker in the coloration, and that part, because it's sitting there shaded, stays blanched. It's a much more pale color, more of a cream color than even a yellow or you don't want it to be green all the way around.
Yeah, that's kind of like how I learned my lesson with pineapple. I brought home a greener one. I thought that was better, but they're not ready to be eaten until they turn real yellow and kind of a brown yellow.
Till they begin to get real golden. As a kid, and I don't know if it was ever true, whenever we would pick out a pineapple, and it was something my mom says, you grabbed one of the leaves near the center of the crown of the pineapple, and you picked it up and kind of shook it. If that leaf came out, the pineapple was ripe.
Oh, really?
And I never had an unripe pineapple. Huh. So
that's another thing. I've never had a bad one. I can't think.
Pineapple. Yeah. Just never eat a whole pineapple by yourself.
Why not?
All right, I'm gonna go pineapple and watermelon, honey. Now. Thanks a lot.
Yep. Have a good day. And as I mumbled to Larry there, don't ever you find a really, and I love pineapple. So it's one of those fabulous fruits. Don't eat like a half of one all by yourself, because you will not be able to taste anything for days. It will just destroy your taste buds, because I did it once in high school.
For how long? How long were you?
It took about 3 days before anything tasted good. And everything was, it was
kind of funny.
But I just couldn't let that pineapple go to waste.
That's kind of funny.
Yeah, we were in school and we were working up towards our the school's big open house, and because it was a high school, vocational school, we were showcasing what we do. And so I had big ham I had done, and all with the aspic glaze over it, and you had the fruit and all of this and that. Well, we didn't use all the pineapple, but it was all cut, sliced, all this and that. It's like, well, eat it. And it's, every time I walked past, I grabbed a piece of pineapple, and next thing you know, I'd eaten like the whole pineapple.
Wow.
Food didn't taste good for days.
I'm sure everybody's done this, but have you ever calculated, and maybe done it roughly, the difference in cost between an already cut fruit, like you can buy pineapple already in the container, or versus the whole pineapple? Right. All the work you have to do to cut that is not that much. Like for to
the
buy
watermelon, it's not much. It's just cubing it up, right?
Yeah. Have you ever thought, wow, it's so much cheaper just to buy the whole thing and cut it? It's not that
it
hard.
It is when it comes to a watermelon. The pineapple is a little, you know, the pineapple's nice when you can just get the whole thing.
Oh, it's always nice to get it cut. Even onions are nice to have them already cut.
Oh, see, no.
But the dollar amount is so much different.
Right. It's like getting hamburger patties. Right.
You buy hamburger already in the patties. Right. Gosh, you're paying a lot of money for somebody to make those little circles.
To do those. And, well, with those, again, it's portion control on that. And if it's like,
but
say,
still,
the
you
cut
could
up,
do that on your
if
own.
If it's the cut up watermelon and things like that, it's the convenience of grabbing that and taking it to work, throwing it into lunch, you know, whatever. But like I said, when my watermelon it gets cut up, it's going to go in a little container so I can take it to work with me.
By the way, there's a subject I wanted to bring up to you that I think is more political than anything else, but it's about the genetically modified organisms.
Okay.
There's a campaign now, and I don't know who's doing it, but I've seen a couple of Facebook posts, and what they're encouraging people to do is not only to sign this petition to get these companies to label everything, which I'm not against that. I'm in favor of that. But if they're not, they actually sell for $25, like 50 labels, that you can go label the food yourself. Just go through the grocery store. And
that's defacing someone's product.
I know. I'm so opposed to that. I think that's crazy.
That's like walking up to someone's automobile and they have an opposing political view sticker on their vehicle, and you putting one on that says that maybe calls them stupid.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, or because something like that. That's not your product.
Because
you can put a sign on your front yard that lists all the companies if you wanted to, and that's fine and dandy.
I'm with you. I think, well, I'm not a scientist, so I don't know if genetically modified is bad or good. I've heard both arguments.
I wish I would have brought the article in. I had it with me last week. It was in a week ago Sunday's paper in the opinion section of the Star Banner.
Mm-hmm.
So we could probably find it and bring it up. It was a very good article in the opinion section, which generally doesn't always go the way I think in a lot of those
opinions.
That's
when you agreed with you?
It was just a well-written, it was one that, that I think took the politics out of it.
Well, I think labeling it, legitimately so that somebody can say, oh, okay, well, I don't mind that. I'm going to buy it.
Well, people have to realize the sweet corn that they buy is not genetically modified. Most of the products that are, the crops that are, yes, they're going into the feed that goes to the meat.
Let me read the label to you. Ready? Yeah. The label that they want you to put on different products says, caution, big, it's a yellow label.
Right.
Caution, may contain genetically engineered ingredients, GMO inside, in big, big letters.
Right.
Now, they tell you to put these stickers on Cheerios, Chobani, whatever the heck that is.
It's a yogurt company.
Okay, Dean Foods, whatever they make, infant formula, and Starbucks coffee. So,
but see, that's if you don't like that Starbucks is doing a product, don't buy it.
But
encourage your family and friends not to purchase it.
I think putting the label on.
It's got to
be a law against that.
I was going to say there's got to be something or a possibility of a type of thing of a standard or a libel or slander type thing coming up after that. It's you make your decisions. You do that some of the things do your research if it's something that absolutely is something you don't want to do. There are ways of, getting around, I guess getting around some of it, of buying organic wheat and things like that where it's not something that's going, and you make your own pasta, et cetera. Yeah, so.
Yeah.
We just have a break coming.
I know, we do have a break. I'm sorry.
The music.
Well, it's not in there, but I can see the clock.
Sure.
But we need to take a little break. We'll be right back after Fox News. If you have a question for Carol Ann, 622-9622.
Fox News Radio. I'm Lillian Wu. The missing Nigerian schoolgirls our planes have been helping search for, now supposedly located but still out of reach.
Nigeria's defense chief claiming that the military now know where the nearly 300 schoolgirls are being held by their Islamic extremist captors. But Air Marshal Alex Bade didn't have good news.
We just leave us alone. We are working. We will get the girls back.
The military explaining they cannot use force to free them because it might put their lives in danger.
Fox Radio's Emily Wither. No classes today at the UC Santa Barbara campus, site of Friday's shooting rampage.
Instead, a memorial is planned for the three men stabbed to death at Elliot Rogers' Isla Vista apartment, the two women shot to death at a nearby sorority house, and another man shot to death at a nearby deli, most of them college students.
Fox Radio's Jeff Manasso. And nine people hurt in North Dakota after a tornado hit an oil worker camp, one person in critical. Fox News, we report, you decide.
Get more control over your small business with ADT Security Services. Through June 1st, get $250 instant savings on select ADT business packages. Get 24/7 burglary monitoring, a motion detector, two wireless cameras, and a lot less worries about your business. Call *ADT from your cell phone. That's *238. It's savings made simple. ADT, our business is helping your business. 36-month monitoring contract required. For applicable terms and conditions, visit ADT.com. Florida, EF0001121.
Right now at Napa, get your favorite flavor of Valvoline Conventional or Max Life Motor Oil for just $3.59 a quart. Buy 5 quarts and you'll also get a $7 mail-in rebate. Yep, $7. Enough to get a plate of bacon with a side of bacon smothered in bacon. Mmm, now that's tasty. Conquer the job with Napa Know-How. General States Pricing. Sales prices do not include applicable state, local taxes, or recycling fees. At participating Napa Auto Parts.
The weather is brought to you by MyFWC.com. Life jackets save lives. We're in Florida. Partly sunny today, but there'll be a thunderstorm in the area this afternoon and evening. The high today, 84 on the coast, 90 inland. And partly cloudy and warm overnight, low 69 to 73. Tomorrow, partly sunny with a thunderstorm around in the afternoon, high 87 to 91. Thursday, times of clouds and sun with a chance of an afternoon thunderstorm, high 86 to 90. From the Florida Weather Center, I'm meteorologist Joe Lundberg.
Do you have areas that have started sagging or drooping? Is what you're looking at not quite the same as it was years ago? Are there enhancements you've been putting off? Is there serious damage you need fixed? Then call on us, Damage Control Services. When your roof is sagging and the drywall is drooping after a storm, or your home just needs some enhancements, from damage repairs to new construction, Damage Control Services is here to help.
Hi, Danny Werfel here. You don't have to sacrifice convenience for local personal service.
At Florida Credit Union, you can transfer your high credit card balances to our rewards card and actually get paid with cash back. You'll enjoy low rates and a customizable card that fits your lifestyle for free.
Never tried a credit union? Maybe it's time for a new game plan.
The Florida Credit Union Wave Card, connecting your money to your life.
Good credits, bad credits. It's none of our business because we're not an auto dealer. We're not a bank. We're not your mother. We're OcalaForSale.com, Marion County's marketplace for cars, trucks, and SUVs. We've got thousands of sellers standing by to take your call. No middleman. But hurry, don't walk, don't run. Just sit down and log on to OcalaForSale.com.
Prices and inventory change daily. Offer does not include dealer upcharge. Undercutting, rust proofing, factory surcharge, or delivery fee. See website for details.
How good does it get?
Golf has long been considered to be sport's most prestigious game, and WOCA has your connection to everything in the golf world. Every first and third Thursday at 10 a.m., tune in for Let's Talk Golf with your host, PGA professional and teacher to the stars, Jim Beckett, and operations manager for the links of Spruce Creek South, Darren Irwin, right here on The Source.
Stay informed on everything going on in the villages with the Village Spectator newspaper. The Village Spectator is exclusively devoted to the villages with news, commentary, and more. And yes, they have Tom's Picks, a free referral for people who are looking for a company to do work for them. Tom's Picks will refer the company that fits your needs, and all we ask is that you tell them where you heard about them. Call Tom's Picks at 804-1223 and pick up your copy of the Village Spectator today.
Now read Ocala Downtown Newspaper online.
All right, 25 minutes before 10 o'clock here at the Paddock Mall. It is currently 79 degrees. Oh, just jumped to 80 degrees. So it's 80 degrees out there right now. Let's rejoin Carol Ann Baldwin. You've got a garden. If you have a question for Carol Ann or simply want to join in on the conversation, you're welcome and invited to do that. The number is the WOCA Climate Control Source Hotline, 622-9622.
There we go.
And we were looking for that opinion piece.
Yeah, I'm trying to find that. Oh, it didn't give me. I went back to the search and it.
But you know that movie, that movie GMO OMG that was at the Marion Theater?
Right.
That, I guess, made a good case for us to be opposed to GMOs.
They were trying on that one.
And, but that was one-sided. And I'm not saying it was bad. I'm just saying it was half of the story, I think.
Right. It was. And, of course, during that same time period, we had the fella. Dr. Folta came in to the Master Gardener Spring Festival that during that same weekend and spoke on the other side of it. But I was just trying to find the one, the article. Let's see if it's, it says it's loading.
See, there was a guy
on the one that was in the paper. And like I said, it was pretty sure it was a week ago from this past Sunday that it was in because I had it and I brought it with me. I thought it was a real good article. I even had stuff highlighted on it and that, but it was...
I couldn't find it when I searched GMO.
If somebody wants to ask a question that... I think I did actually find it.
Oh, you did?
Yeah.
Let me just give the number again, 622-9622 if you want to call. And the other day at the... farm market, the Saturday farm market downtown.
Okay, right.
There was a guy standing on the corner with a handmade sign protesting Monsanto, basically.
Right.
And a crudely done sign. By the way, if you're going to stand with a sign, use paint or something. If you use a ballpoint pen, it's hard to read that thing from the road. So anyway, he was protesting Monsanto, and I understand the concern, and I want to know more, and I think that the people who are opposed to it are making some really good points that are sinking in, but I don't know that it's across the board, and I think that's the problem I'm having with this.
Right, and with within the article, I guess what it was, I'm remembering some of it now that. Some of the research that was opposed to it a few years ago have had to come back and recount and pull back because they were wrong or that they took and stretched.
But is it kind of like the gluten argument? In other words, are some GMOs... food that is what is it called, genetically modified, are some of them affecting people simply because they react to it a certain way?
Biggest thing with the GMO kind of
does anybody react to anything that's GMO?
I don't know if they've actually been able to say they have. I mean, the one issue that did come up was when they tried to do something with the potato in order to make the potato toxic to the potato beetle, made the potato toxic. And that was the only thing that I know of that was truly... a bad thing. And it was, unmarketable. Of course, you can't eat this. But anything else so far, they have not, I don't think they've ever found anything that made them bad. But the biggest issue, and to me, and this is the right of the property owner of being able to grow on his field non-genetically modified if he would like to. And the problems that happen is if an adjacent farm is growing Roundup resistant product, corn, soybean, something like that, and this guy over here is growing an heirloom, an open poppy, one that's not genetically modified, there's the possibility of a cross-pollination. And most cross-pollinations do not affect that year's harvest. What it does affect would be the next year's seed. But even still, you don't it's your right to not have that. You know, same thing with an organic farm. The organic farm regulations, in order to be able to consider it an organic farm, is that you've not used any pesticides or any synthetic pesticides, fertilizers, etc., for a certain period of time. It could have been a full chemical farm at one time, and you buy into it and you say, I'm going to make this organic. You go through step by step by step in order to receive that certification, because that's what you want. That is something you have a passion for. And then somebody moves in next to you and he's going through with a crop duster spraying his melons with fungicide every 2 weeks, and it's got a drift across on yours. You are no longer an organic farm because of that drift. And that's where, you know, it's more property rights to me and the right of making your selections. We were talking about this labeling thing, and there are companies that are coming out and labeling their products.
Vermont just passed some kind of a law.
Passed theirs, and that's what, that's, I think, part of what that article was. But, I mean, Florida hasn't, but if the company's smart, it's just all the labeling changes across the board on everything on going through it. But
well, it's like when peanut allergies became an issue, they all started putting peanut allergy alerts or warnings on labels.
On labels, and it's on anything that is made in the plant that would have had
that in there. Right.
But yeah, I think most of it, it's being able to make that selection, being able to make that choice on your own of whether or not you're going to consume it. A friend on Facebook put forth a, I'm not sure where he got the piece, but it says, you know, going back, look back at what, you know, our forebears actually ate and go back to eating that. Stay away from the grains and this and that. You know, our, you know, 200 years ago, 300 years ago, we weren't eating donuts and cornflakes and things like that. We ate whole grains and whole things and whole foods. We ate butter. We drank whole milk that had the fat in it. Well, whatever, minus what we took out to make our butter. Our jams and jellies were made. Our jams and jellies were made from fruit and honey or sugar that was done, you know, like a cane syrup, but generally sweetened on their own. You know, those kind of things. And that if you're doing that, and especially if you're able to grow any of these items yourself, they ate eggs, they ate beef, they ate pork, they ate, but they didn't eat all of these other processed grains and things like that. I think that's where people need to consider the problems in your diet and your nutrition and cancer and heart disease and all the rest of it that everyone likes to link back to one thing. It's take a look at what's in your cupboard. You know, people like to compare the American diet with those of Europeans and Asians. We have mega supermarkets in this country. We walk in, we drive there once a week, and we buy everything, or we buy once a month. You know, those who may be on like EBT cards and things like that, they go in and they buy 6 boxes of cereal, and they buy pancake mix, and they buy the corn syrup syrup for their pancakes, and they buy the tub o' margarine and the white bread.
Tub o' margarine.
And the chicken nuggets, if they've got anywhere near a chicken, you know, it's called a, you know, chicken nugget, the battered fish stick kind of thing, and look at all of what those ingredients are. It's not just fish and cornmeal, it's many, many other ingredients in that. And I think truly, if you look back and you look at that versus the other, so if you can grow it yourself, it's, you know, you're going to be doing a, you know, a better thing on your, on your fresh produce and things like that, eating what's in season locally, and maybe foregoing having some of those other items when it's actually off season, you know, or buying it flash frozen. It's, there's nothing wrong with buying, you know, that.
Have you had almond milk?
I haven't, but that's, here's another thing.
I had some. It was pretty good.
It wasn't. That's another thing. My understanding from beekeepers Almonds are the dirtiest crop.
There's always out something. There
because they, what There's they a- have to spray on those trees
really?
In order to get a crop
oh, man.
All the way to harvest.
They say the same thing about tilapia. It's the dirtiest fish.
Not if you buy it in Citra.
But see, but no matter what I say I want, I like, I've discovered something new. It's the dirtiest one there is.
Yeah, but...
I got a hot dog.
You can actually get it.
It's in dirty water.
But no, that I mean that when beekeepers take their bees to the almond grove or orchards, I'm not sure if it's almonds or orchards or groves, they actually have to bring them back onto other fields that are clean in order to throw away all the honey that's manufactured
wow.
after the almond
really?
Pollinization because it's basically it's contaminated.
Really,
that's. What I've my understanding,
and that creeps into the almond milk that I paid $4 a half gallon for.
It's quite possible, but I mean, there's another one of those things. If we think, oh, we're going to something different, it's not cow's milk; it's almond milk. I am lactose intolerant, so I'm drinking this.
And I'm not lactose intolerant.
No, and because people say, well, I'm not going to drink the soy milk because the soy milk is from genetically modified soybean.
And we have.
I'm going to go to the almond milk.
Bad
well,
for
your
you.
Almond, your almond. Trees from that, unless it's an organic, you know, almond orchard, has been sprayed with chemicals.
So do you like soy sauce?
Yeah.
Oh, me too.
You got to have that on your rice.
I know.
It works. I marinate with it. I use it. Yeah. But, yeah, so it's those kind of things. You gotta realize, you know, if you truly, you know, if people do have food allergies, and I think we have a lot of the food allergies by read the labels. All the other stuff that's put into the products. The MSG, the monosodium glutamate, it's a flavor enhancer. It's probably one of the worst things.
Do you remember that?
There's people who, you know, you'll get a headache after eating, especially Asian food.
Do you remember that stuff you used to shake on? What was it called?
Yeah, the accent or something
accent.
Like that.
I used to love that.
Monosodium glutamate.
Yes, I know.
Yeah,
and it was good. Did you like it? It really was good.
It'll for some people, it'll give you a headache.
But. Maybe that's why I don't get a headache anymore so much, because I don't think they even sell it anymore, do they? I think they stopped.
I think they probably still do, but
do you know
yeah, most
love?
People, it's again, it's taking some of those additives.
Have you ever had like crazy salt, like Maria's?
Oh yeah, because you mixed up salt, James.
James, thank you. Yeah, I love that.
Yeah, it's a good one too. But again, you know. Read some of those things in the label. Grow as much of your own as you can, if possible. Buy it as local as you can, if possible. You said tilapia. You heard tilapia is a dirty fish, or where it's farm raised. Where it's farm raised is dirty. No, you can actually buy locally farm raised. Hormone-free, blah, 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 all that other stuff is missing from this. That's the bad stuff right here grown in Citra.
And then they say salmon is good for you. And then they say, no, only Alaskan salmon.
Wild-caught, wild-harvest salmon.
Yeah, in Alaska.
Right. Well, they.
What's wrong with the Atlantic Ocean? You can't.
We don't have good salmon. I don't
why? Guess. What's wrong with the Atlantic?
We don't have salmon in Florida.
Well, not in Florida, but up north. Don't they have it up north?
I don't know.
Like in Norway and things?
Well, the North Atlantic, I'm not sure.
Yeah, we think so. Good morning. You're on the air with Carol Ann.
We're not talking gardening too much. Get us back in line.
I come from about a 4 or 5 generation family that hates fish, and I've been trying to learn to like it because it's supposed to be good for you.
Right.
And I found that the mild fishes, like tilapia, were pretty tasty.
Yes.
But the thing is, when I buy it, if you look at the ingredients, there aren't anything nutrition-wise, there's nothing in it. And I just wonder if you could comment on that, and I'll hang up and listen to it on the radio.
Well, okay. Well, yeah. Well, with fish, it's a protein. It doesn't have a bunch of your
but
other
would
stuff.
But they list the
But they don't list other...
When you buy beef, it all says it's beef.
It's beef,
it doesn't
right.
say
it doesn't
the ingredients list, of the beef itself.
Right. Well, because beef is beef.
Well, so it's, fish
and
is fish.
Fish is fish. The only thing that's usually shown that's added might be a... like a preservative brine that they were
right.
treated with in order to protect them from freezer burn. And again, you have to, you know, you watch for that. Yeah, it's a little frustrating when we go in the market and we have a country as large as we have, and you look at the fish that's frozen in the freezer cases, and it's all from Asia. You know, really? And it's, you're going, okay, is this up to our standards? But then again, we claim our standards are so high, but we're one of few nations that still are, you know, that, that allow certain things to go through that other countries don't. So it's, okay, maybe their standards are actually higher than ours some things. On some things, not all. But
a lot of these health guys and ladies that write books will tell us that the smaller the fish, the less likely it'll have mercury in it. Right. So they're saying eat sardines and whatever.
Right,
guppies.
Right. Well, you know, swallow goldfish. No, but I mean, the tilapia, all those things, they're all good for, and I think what it is, it's just strictly a protein. Some of the other stuff you would probably have to pick up through research on like the iron and things like that.
And they do eat vegetables.
Yeah.
Some algae.
Right.
Or something.
Right.
Good morning. You're on the air with Carol Ann.
Good morning, everybody.
Hey. Good morning.
A quick question.
Yeah.
Not on planting and that, but where is the place in Citra where you get that tilapia?
That is a good question.
I don't have his card, but if you go out to the 326 market on Thursday afternoon, he's usually out there, and you can get his card because you can actually get it right from the farm. You know, he will harvest for you before you come in. You can either have them whole or dressed, et cetera. So it is a good thing. Larry is trying to look it up. Kathy, if you're out there, give me a
holler. Is it Ben's Tilapia
Farm? Yes, it is, yeah.
Ben's Tilapia Farm, I found it. It's at, are you ready?
Yes.
Are you there? Here's the phone number, first of all, 352. I hope I can give this on the air.
Hey, it's, I guess.
362-4278. And they're located on 12847. Northeast 7th Avenue in Citra. And they have a Facebook page, so you just go to Ben's Tilapia Farm on Facebook.
How'd you spell a first name?
Ben.
Ben, like Ben Franklin?
Yeah.
Okay.
Like Ben's Tilapia.
Yeah, Ben's Tilapia. I figured he would know Ben Franklin.
Right, better, yeah.
Oh, but that's great. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
You all have a good day. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
And yeah. I'm looking at pictures of them. They will sell them to you whole or filleted.
Right, or filleted. How? Right. And he does a few other little
baked
like
into
fish
muffins?
Cakes. And, yeah,
oh, that's
fish,
what that is?
Fish cakes and things like that. And it's, you know, it's good. And again, that's, you know, it's one of those things that, you know, you may go into your local grocery store and you can buy tilapia a lot cheaper. But then again, it's being
really?
It's from a processing thing. His is fresh. You know that when you get that fish from him, it's going to be fresh. Same way we have some local meat places that are grass-raised beef, and you can find free-range chicken where you can get your eggs and things like that, that it's local. Realize you're going to pay more than what you're going to pay for it in the supermarket. But you yourself are making a conscious decision to look for something that may be a little more of a whole food, not as processed. You know, when you're looking at labels on things, the less the processing, of course, the better, the shorter the shelf life. But that's okay. You know, when you're doing you're getting your produce, getting it fresh is going to be, you know, a lot, you know, healthier. And, oh, I had started to say about the thing of where, you know, they try to compare our diets to those around the nation, especially with the obesity rates and the heart disease and cancers and things like that. In other countries, they have big markets in every town, and people go there daily. They get out, you know, they go and they walk to the market with their basket and they get
their fresh, they're walking all
the time. They get their fresh produce and they get the things right fresh from the farms, the local bakeries and things like that, where they're not using preservatives. That loaf of bread that they buy may only last them 2 to 3 days because it was, you know, it doesn't have the preservatives in.
I love
and
bakery
that you're eating,
bread.
You know, fresh
bakery
bread, fresh
bread is
bakery,
so much better than the
right. I've given up a lot of bread recently. I've just
by the way, I'm going to turn the computer screen around. There's a picture on Ben's Tilapia's Facebook page, and it shows the size of a hatchling, a tiny little fish sitting on his finger.
On his finger. It's almost the size of a hangnail.
Yeah, or yeah. like a piece of rice or something.
Right, a grain of rice.
Yeah, it's a tiny, tiny little fish that will grow into something
that's,
edible.
Edible.
And so there you go.
Yep.
So that would be, I mean, if you were worried about mercury, I would think that that would be non-existent.
And hormones, you know, he grows his hormone free, and all that. He breeds all of his own fish, so he knows that, you know, the breeding stock and all of that.
The town known for its citrus, right?
Right. And actually, I think that's when it says citrus, that's because that's a mailing address. He's actually in Spar.
Oh, really?
Yeah, Spar has a post office, but they don't deliver mail. Citra has the mail delivery. Okay. So it becomes a mailing address. Physical address is there, but if you tried to Google it, it's going to throw you off in a weird...
Let me see.
Give him a phone call.
Let's see if I can zoom in on it on the Google Earth, whatever you call it, Street View or whatever it's called. And then I'll see if I see little fish ponds.
See little fish. They're under. They are within a structure, because otherwise you then have the problem of herons and other ospreys and other birds of prey coming through and making a meal of your industry there. But yeah, I know we did get off the line of growing things today. Sort of. Besides growing plants and things, we're growing everything else. This time of year, it's starting to get hot. A lot of the stuff in the vegetable gardens is going to sort of dwindle down a bit, unless you've got your okra, eggplant, southern peas going in. It's a good time that if your crops are beginning to finish up, that you can solarize in the garden to remove the microorganisms, some of the damaging organisms that are in there, weed seed, fungus spores, and things like that. Get your beds ready for fall, which is going to come up. We'll be starting to plant again for fall in, say, August and early September, where we'll start over again with tomatoes and more green beans and squash and all of those things. So, if you've been enjoying your harvest of your own, or you didn't get as much harvest out of it, you can always hit some of the farmers' markets, and you want to can up some beans and tomatoes, or freeze them. All are acceptable ways of preserving them. Make sure you if you're canning, know what you're doing on some of those things. Green beans are very low acid foods and really do take some special processing or a pressure canning, not pressure cooking, but pressure canning, in order to make sure that they're safe to eat once they're finished. Nothing worse than spending hours and hours a day or two preserving all this produce, and then find out that you didn't process it properly, and you've got a shelf full of botulism sitting there ready to explode. Make sure you do it right. If you're not sure, go through the University of Florida. They have some information. I think even Extension still has some pointers or can aim you to the right pages that would be available. So, you can always call over there and look for the home economics type portion of it. So, you can call over there, 671-8400, and, preserved by some of your own, what you've grown or what you've picked up at the local produce markets.
All right, I know I'm kind of throwing this here at the end, but we have a $20 gift certificate to Bob Wines I want to give away. I have a trivia question that will win it, and here's the question.
All right.
What vegetable was mentioned today, which name comes from an Aztec word which literally means plump thing with a navel? We mentioned it today. It's from an Aztec word that means plump thing with a navel. If I read the Aztec word to you, you'd probably get it real quickly. And I'll do that in a second if nobody guesses it. But it's an Aztec word, means plump thing with a navel. It's where we get the word for this vegetable. And I'll give you a hint. Sometimes
it's a vegetable.
Sometimes it's a fruit.
Ah.
Or maybe there's an argument about that. So that might help you right there. It's one of those arguments. It's vegetable, it's a fruit.
Right.
So let me see if I can get somebody here. Good morning. What do you think I'm talking about?
Hi. Is it a tomato?
Tomato is exactly right.
Bingo.
Yeah. Is this Kathy?
Yay.
That's nice. All right. You got a $20 gift certificate to Bob Wines.
Thank you so much. I appreciate it.
Thank you. And real quick, where I got that from, it says that the Aztec word zitomatl.
There you go.
XITOMATL, which is where we get the word tomato. Plump thing with a navel is what
plump
it really
thing
means.
Thing with a navel.
Ah, Carolyn, we gotta run.
We gotta run. Once day's over. Another one's gone.
Absolutely.
We'll see you in June.
You will. It'll be good. June it'll next be time. June. It'll be almost summertime by the time you get here.
Yep.
All right, we will take a little break and be right back after Fox News. This is WOCA Ocala.
Fox News Radio, I'm Lillian Wu. Reports of dozens of rebels killed as a struggle for a key part of eastern Ukraine rages on.
Ukrainian troops and pro-Russian rebels continue gun battles as Ukraine launched airstrikes and a paratrooper assault at Donetsk's international airport for the second day in a row. A spokesman for Ukraine's anti-terrorist operation says rebels are no longer inside the airport terminal.
Fox Radio's Jessica Gallagher. The search continues for three people missing after a huge mudslide in western Colorado.
Near Colbrand, Colorado.
The slide, it's an understatement to say that it is massive.
Mesa County Sheriff Stan Hilke says the mud and debris in some areas is believed to be at least 250 feet deep. The recent heavy rain to blame. There are some energy industry tanks on the mountain that are being drained.
Fox Radio's Jennifer Kuiper. And home prices still rising in March, but the pace of gains slowing with fewer able to afford to buy. Fox.